Late this evening in Baghdad, Reuters reported that Iraq Shiite and Sunni political leaders, including the prime minister, made a joint call for national unity. Tonight, we take a closer look at what the Iraq crisis and its sectarian divisions mean for an already volatile region. I'm joined by Hisham Melhem, Washington bureau chief of Al Arabiya News Channel, and Mary Jane Deeb, chief of the African and Middle Eastern Division of the Library of Congress, but the views she expresses here are her own. What is the danger, Hisham, that this Sunni-Shiite split, which we've become so familiar with now, is going to spread beyond the borders of Iraq throughout the entire region?
What we see now in terms of Shia-Sunni rivalry is unprecedented in the history of Islam. This is the first time we see bloodletting on a continuum front from Iraq to Syria to Lebanon. And if you add to it occasional flare-ups in Bahrain and Yemen, you will get an idea. This has never happened in modern history or even any time throughout the history of Islam. That's why it's extremely dangerous. When you add to that the fact that you have two major Arab countries that are literally unraveling along sectarian ethnic fault lines, Syria and Iraq, you add to that refugee problems in two brittle countries, Lebanon and Jordan. You add to that dearth of leadership in the region. You add to that dearth of leadership in Europe, which makes American leadership extremely important. Unfortunately, American leadership also was absent in the last 2 years. Because we didn't do much about the rise of ISIS in the so-called Islamic State in Iraq and Syria, because we didn't do much to check their power in Syria, allowed that environment, allowed them to fester in that environment, we see them now moving from Syria to Iraq. And now, one final point, we have two major non-state actors, Hezbollah and ISIS, throwing their weight around the region and acting like states. Never happened before.
Some people say that the other acronym for ISIS, which is ISIL, is actually scarier than ISIS because it's about more than Syria. It's about the entire region, the Levant. I want to ask you, Mary Jane Deeb, about whether this conflict that Hisham describes isn't just becoming regional, but it already is.
Well, it is in many ways, because the idea of ISIS and the idea of the Islamist group is not simply to change a particular government within a particular region. It is to change the region as a whole, to turn it into an Islamic state. And so we see the situation developing along a number of lines. Not only is it sectarian, Sunni Shiite, but I think there is also an actor that we do not see, and that is, I would say, the old army, Iraqi army, the army that has been broken up and sent back home. And that may be the background, the backstage, if you want, of what is happening in Iraq today.
There was a lot of attention paid in Vienna this week when there was some discussion on the sidelines between the U.S. and Iran. How critical a player is or should Iran be in the middle of all of this?
Iran is on the ascendancy throughout the Middle East. That's why Iranian power, projection of power in Syria, now projection of power in Iraq, Iranian influence in Lebanon through its proxy Hezbollah is scaring the countries of the Gulf and Turkey. These are Sunni powers who are extremely concerned about the rise of the Iranian role, and now they will be more concerned because of signs that the United States is willing to discuss Iraq with Iran. And in fact, even John Kerry yesterday said it in a fleeting moment that we may even be willing to collaborate militarily. This is going to create...
Well, he pulled back from
that. He pulled back, of course. I mean, you know, this is the first time in American history we have four most senior positions occupied by senators, and senators talk. That's what they do, unfortunately. but the point is, Iran's influence in Iraq, and now the Iranians are calling on the United States to collaborate with it militarily. This is the same Iran that was responsible for the death of hundreds and hundreds of Marines and American soldiers in Iraq in the past 10 years. But now we're contemplating dealing with it.
But more immediately, does this or any collaboration that might exist, whether it's diplomatically or otherwise with Iran, does that put our nuclear talks on the back burner?
Absolutely. And this is one of the major dangers, is that if we start talking now about what is happening in Iraq, we are stopping the discussion on the nuclear issue. And that is of immense importance, because Iran can play the game of, yes, let's talk about Iraq, and yes, let's move, and let's do this, and in a way, continue building up its nuclear forces.
Almost every country that you mentioned, including and also including Libya and Egypt and Turkey, have a different, they have different skin in this game, a different concerns about what's going to happen in Iraq. Is there any agreed upon solution other than that the U.S. ought to do something?
Well, I mean, I would say that Saudi Arabia is worried about Iranian influence, primarily. That is its major worry, and probably would like to see a more important role played by the United States. But the other countries have different agendas. A number of countries would like to see the Sunnis come back to power in Iraq. And certainly, I would say that countries like Egypt, for instance, would like to see a return and a strengthening of Sunnis in the region.
Would these countries perhaps like to see Iraq partitioned?
I think in my moments of despair, I think we are watching the death of a country. This whole political order that emerged in the Middle East following the First World War, a century later now, is falling. It's falling apart along sectarian ethnic lines. And the Kurds, I would argue, will go their own separate way. Maybe the Shia will go their own separate way in the south, and that would leave the Sunnis in the center.
This is something Joe Biden talked about years ago, but was rejected out of hand.
Exactly, but not through this kind of violence. Yeah. The Sunnis will be sullen and angry and armed, and they're not going to accept a situation like that.
But ISIS continue to exist, even if this kind of deal comes up. So the question becomes, because ISIS has access to a lot of resources, a lot of money, part of the question is, who is giving them this money? Are any of these regional actors also helping to support this insurgency?
It is very possible. It is very possible that some of them are supporting, that money is coming in. It could be individuals, it could be foundations, it could even be governments.
And now they're generating their own funds. Already they got hundreds of millions of dollars from Mosul banks.
By attacking banks, by attacking shops, attacking economic institutions.
Imposing protection taxes.
It's like the mafia. But I think there is more serious financing of these groups.
But what you need in the end, you need a political solution. You need allies to fight ISIS. And that was our main mistake in Syria. We did not invest in the moderate Syrian opposition so that they will take on these groups and nip their threat in the butt. We didn't do that.
Who is Nouri al-Maliki's friend in the region in all of this?
Iran.
Does he have
it?
Iran, without any doubt.
Only Iran.
That's the danger. That is the danger, because Iran might be asked to move in,
and it has already troops in. And he owes his political future to them.
Yeah.
So is there a pressure from any of these nations, or from us, mm-hmm. or should there be, from Maliki to move aside?
I think the United States should have exercised that option a while ago. I blame the Bush administration for living with him without really exercising too much pressure on him. The same thing with the Obama administration. He owes his position to American bayonets. And we didn't act as such.
Final word.
However, who is going to take his place and through what process? After all, he was elected. And so who are we expecting to take over? It has to be, I suppose, a coalition that needs to be pulled together. And I don't know who can do that.
Seems like the same dilemmas cropped up, heads up periodically, replacing people. But either they don't go or you can't find someone to take their place.
That's
it's
right.
Quite remarkable. Hisham Melhem, Mary Jane Deeb, thank you both.
Thank you.
Thank you.